For the father of Sister Sara Rizwi. His name was Sayyid Asghar Rizwi, Ibn Sayyid Hamid Rizwi, and also for the aunt, the khala of Sayyid Hajj Sayyid Sajid. Her name was Sayyida Shahzad Zaidi bint Sayyid Ya'war Hussein Zaidi, and for his uncle, Dr. Sayyid Javed Zaidi ibn Sayyid Iqbal Zaidi. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. أعوذ بالله السميع العليم من الشيطان الغوي الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين وصلى الله على محمد وآله الطيبين الطاهرين صلى الله عليك يا سيدي ويا مولاي يا رسول الله وعلى أهل بيتك المعصومين المظلومين صلى الله عليك وعلى ولدك المظلوم أبي عبد الله جعفر بن محمد الصادق لعن الله الظالمين لكم سيدي من الأولين والآخرين ما خاب والله من تمسك بكم وأمن من لجأ والتجأ إليكم يا ليتنا فيا ليتنا كنا معكم سادتي فنفوز فوزا عظيما بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم يا أيها الذين آمنوا أطيعوا الله وأطيعوا الرسول وأولي الأمر منكم فإن تنازعتم في شيء فردوه إلى الله والرسول إن كنتم تؤمنون بالله واليوم الآخر ذلك خير وأحسن تأويلا ألم تر إلى الذين يزعمون أنهم آمنوا بما أنزل إليك وما أنزل من قبلك يريدون أن يتحاكموا إلى الطاغوت وقد أمروا أن يكفروا به ويريد الشيطان أن يضلهم ضلالا بعيدا آمنا بالله صدق الله العلي العظيم والسلام عليكم جميعا ورحمة الله وبركاته To begin, I want to offer my condolences to Hajj Sara Rizwi, Hajj Sayyid Sajid, and I know there are many people who have lost their respected elders and relatives in the last few weeks due to primarily COVID-19, but certainly due to other reasons. And the loss of the loved one is never easy, regardless of the cause of death. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to shower the marhumin with his mercy and to raise them with Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad alayhim as-salatu was-salam, and to make their final abode to be Jannah with Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad alayhim as-salatu was-salam. We today are sitting to commemorate the Shahada of Al-Imam Abi Abdullah Jafar ibn Muhammad ibn al-Sadiq alayhim as-salam. And there is so much you can talk about his life and so much to talk about how what he left for us as a legacy, as our Imam, as our guide, has shaped who we are, not only as Muslims, but certainly as human beings and as the followers of this great house, the house of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam. And I want to begin very simply. that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when He revealed this religion to us, when He provided us with this code of life that was revealed to all of the prophets, from Adam alayhi salam to Nuh to Ibrahim to Musa to Isa, and finally culminating and being sealed and perfected with Habiballah Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam, that He was providing a code for life, and that that code of life is not missing anything. It is not, there's no part of life that it does not address. It addresses every part of that life. The first part, the simplest part that it addresses, is what we call taklif. Taklif, it means that you are in a state of obligation. You are in a state in which you feel obliged to God. You feel obliged because your Creator has given you a set of gifts. He has bestowed upon you certain things that you are obliged to fulfill. And that taklif is the simplest and most basic aspect of who we are as the servants of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When you raise your children and you teach them about salat, you teach them about fasting, you teach them about paying their khums, you teach them about any of the obligations that they must do, you are teaching them taklif. And you begin by teaching them that this is what God has demanded of you. And if you don't do it, you will incur the anger of Allah and you will commit a sin. But beyond that, we seldom move forward and say, how does this impact my life? And how does this make me a better human being? Yes, taklif is the ultimate objective, is to fulfill what God wants us to do. We do what He says we should do. We stay away from what He has prohibited. But in the end, the goal is to get closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The goal is to rise spiritually towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because you see, there are many people who fulfill their religious obligations. They pray, they fast, they do Hajj, but they are not rising towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And so any amount of taklif that you perform, prayers, zakat, Hajj, anything that you do, that you are fulfilling because God commanded it of you, you are doing because you want ma'rifatullah. You want to understand and know God in your heart. You want to rise, and your salat should lead you to that. Your fasting should lead you to that. And every aspect of what your religion teaches you should lead you to that. So for instance, it should also be your akhlaq. Your akhlaq should lead you to have a greater understanding of God. How is that so? That, well, if I am in a situation where I have to be merciful to somebody, someone who has wronged me, I do so because God is the most merciful, because I am trying to adopt characteristics that God has showed to me. If someone is in need and I am generous with them and I give them generosity and I share with them what I have been given by Allah, I am doing so because Allah is the most generous, because Allah is the most kind, because Allah doesn't turn anyone away. In the same way, all of those akhlaq are leading us towards the ma'rifah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and a consciousness that, imagine at a time that when you do something good, when you do something that sacrifices your own happiness for the good of somebody else, and you do so realizing that I'm doing this because my Allah has been so good to me, because my Allah has given everything to me, because Allah has been merciful and forgiving of me, so then I must do that and reflect that in my actions. This is the ma'rifah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So just like with taklif, with having to pray and having to fast, you inculcate into yourself certain qualities that by which you are going to have a greater understanding of your Lord, of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that step by step reaches you closer to God. Al-Imam al-Sadiq alayhi salatu wassalam, he explains in a very beautiful hadith that is reported from him, in which he says, "Inna ma'rifata Allahi azza wa jal anisun min kulli wahsha." He says, understanding God, to know Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, is you seeking safety and safeguarding and relief from all bewilderment. Anything that's going to shake you in life, anything that's going to cause you to be rattled, to become anxious, the ma'rifah of Allah, knowing Allah, understanding Allah, will save you from that. He says, وَصَاحِبٌ مِنْ كُلِّ وَحْجَةٍ. He says, knowing Allah and understanding God means that you will never feel lonely, that God will always be there, no matter physically whether anyone is with you or not. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will be with you. وَنُورٌ مِنْ كُلِّ ظُلْمَةٍ. Having understanding of God is that lantern that will enlighten your life and take the darkness away from it. وَقُوَّةٌ مِنْ كُلِّ ضَعْفٍ. Having understanding of God is going to strengthen you such that you will never have weakness inside of you. وَشِفَاءٌ مِنْ كُلِّ سَقَمٍ. You will have healing. You will be healed from any form of sickness or ailment or disease. You will be free of those. That is what the understanding of God does. But how is that, my dear brothers and sisters? That understanding of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, how does it come? Does it mean I sit on my prayer mat and I just pray all day? They say Al-Imam Abu Abdullah Jafar ibn Muhammad al-Sadiq alayhim as-salam, one day he had gone out, he was walking, it was very hot, he had gone to one of his properties and he had taken with him a pickaxe or some tool and he was digging the ground and it was very hot. It was very hot and he was digging the ground and working hard and the perspiration is streaming down his forehead. A companion saw him and he came and he said, Ya Ibn Rasulillah, grandson of the Prophet. He says, how is it that you are struggling and working so hard like this? I am here. Let me help you. Let me take this from you. My dear brothers and sisters, Al-Imam As-Sadiq, he turns to his companion. He says, no, it is most befitting. It is more befitting that I do this work, that the work that is being done on this ground is done by me. Why? Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves those who work hard, those who expend their energy. In the same way, in the middle of the night, one companion describes that Al-Imam As-Sadiq alayhi salatu wassalam, he says, I was sleeping and I heard somebody walking down the street and I woke up. And when I followed this person in the middle of the night, when everyone was sleeping, I saw that it was none other than my master, Jafar ibn Muhammad ibn As-Sadiq alayhi salam. He says, I followed behind him because I was afraid that in the middle of the night, God forbid someone were to attack him or someone were to harm him in some way. So I wanted to help. He says, I saw him carrying something on his back and suddenly I heard a tear or something break and everything sort of fell to the ground. I heard the sound of things falling to the ground. And I saw him fall to the ground and start to pick things up, whatever it was that had fallen. As I came close to Al-Imam As-Sadiq in the darkness of the night, I couldn't see what he was doing, but I could hear him saying under his breath that, Ya Allah, help me in this difficult task of mine. Help me fulfill what I need to fulfill. He comes forward, the companion, he says, I saw Al-Imam As-Sadiq picking up loaves of bread, packages of food that were in this big sack that he was carrying on his back. I said to him, Ya Ibn Rasulillah, let me help you. Let me pick up these loaves with you and carry them and we can take it to the destination that you were going towards. Al-Imam As-Sadiq, he says, no. He says, this task is mine. The task is on me. The responsibility is on me to do this. So let me carry it. So he picked up the loaves and my master Jafar ibn Muhammad ibn As-Sadiq alayhim as-salam went on his way in the middle of the night distributing loaves to the poor, the destitute and the hungry. My dears, Al-Imam As-Sadiq alayhi salam shows that he took it upon himself to enact what it meant to be a Muslim, to enact what it meant to be the servant of God. Indeed, you can sit on the prayer mat and you can pray hundreds of prayers and just say, Ya Allah, give me your ma'rifah. 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 That ma'rifah may not come into you. Why? Because Islam is a religion of action. Islam is a religion of implementation that along with sitting on the mat, along with pondering on what Allah has created and why Allah has created it, the system he has made, Allah says, the only way to get closeness to me and to understand who I am is to enact what I tell you to enact. Meaning, if I tell you to pray at a certain time, pray at that time. If I tell you to give khums in a certain way, give khums in a certain way. If I tell you to go do Hajj in a certain way, go do Hajj in a certain way. Don't try to overturn or override what I have created for you in the system of Islam with what you think is correct. that will not bring you closer to to understanding of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that's why you see in the lives of the Masumeen, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam, Ahlul Bayt alayhim as-salatu wa salam, that not only were they prayerful, not only did they worship, did they have their head on the ground in sajda, that they spent their time in prostration, that they were doing dhikr, but that they implemented in their practical life how to live. They're dealing with their spouses, they're dealing with companions, they're dealing in trials and difficulties, trade, business, everything had a system that reinforced ma'rifah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Why? Because it's the system. And Allah says, the more you seek to find that system, the more you seek to live by the system, the closer I will bring you to me. The closer I will have you come towards me, and I will open the eyes of your heart. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He reminds us that He has sent these individuals as a beacon to us. And that these individuals, they point to the path that will take you to the understanding of Allah. And indeed, you know this, that it is Imam Ali alayhi salatu wassalam who said that لَوْ انْكَشَفَ عَنِّ الْغِطَاءِ مَزْدَدْتُ إِيمَانًا or مَا ازْدَدْتُ يَقِينًا. He says, if Imam Ali says this, he says, if the veil was taken away from my eyes, as it happens to people when they die and they see the empyrean of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Imam Ali says, even if they took that veil away from my eye, I would not increase in iman, nor would I increase in certainty, because my iman is already complete. And so Allah has placed these individuals in front of us, and He has made them that role model for us. Al-Imam al-Sadiq alayhi salatu wassalam was particularly important in a certain way. Why? Because in his time, particularly midway through his imamat, the Banu Umayyah had become weak. The Banu Umayyah were about to be toppled because the Banu Abbas were already planning and they were scheming to take control. And in fact, they had used their relationship to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam through the uncle of Rasulullah to gain the favor of people, saying, we are the family of Rasulullah. And so during this time, Al-Imam al-Sadiq alayhi salam, in keeping with the legacy of his father Al-Baqir alayhi salam, had a great school. Medina at this point now was thriving. Many people would come. There were several centers of learning. There was Medina itself, which was a center of learning. Kufa, which was left behind from the time of Imam Ali alayhi salam, was a center of learning. Baghdad had some learning in it, particularly in the time of the Banu Abbas. And there was learning that was coming from outside of the Muslim world, from Rome, from the Far East, people coming from all over the place. And now they would descend into Medina. In Medina, in the time of Al-Imam al-Sadiq alayhi salam, there was a lot of open discourse. And not only was there a lot of discourse, but you see that the people were discussing many different aspects of religion. They were discussing the Quranic sciences, namely, how do you recite the Quran properly? Namely, how do you interpret the Quran properly? Namely, what is the sha'n al-nuzul? What is the reason behind the revelation of certain verses of the Holy Quran? These were being discussed by groups of people. Other topics that were being discussed in that time of Medina were the usul of our religion, the fundamentals. This means people would sit down and they would talk about the nature of God. Some would come and say, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, His unity, His when He says He is one, He says He has tawheed, it means X, Y, and Z. They would explain it. And then someone else would come and retort that and explain that no, Allah's tawheed is explained in a different way. They would talk about the nature of the risala of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam. There would be discussions of the basics of faith, meaning something known as munajjiziyya and mu'adhiriyya, in which you have systems where people are considered to be guilty of what they do versus not being guilty. And in fact, you see at the time of Al-Imam al-Sadiq alayhi salatu wassalam that many groups began to form. One of those groups was obviously us, the Shi'i, the Ithna Ashari, and many people called the Ja'fari Imami group, the sect that was there at that time. There were the Zaydis who were there at that time, who were an offshoot of Shi'ism, who were the followers of Zayd ibn Ali, Zainul Abidin, who was martyred in an uprising. They were also the followers of Yahya ibn Zayd. There were also people known as the Murji'a, who I'm sure I have told you about. The Murji'a, these were people who believed, and they would have discourses with others, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created humanity and he instilled inside of them and he gave to them an opportunity to have faith. And when a person has faith, whether they practice it or show it, it doesn't matter. Allah will only judge them based on what is in their heart. So what they claimed in an extreme fashion was that if you believe and you commit sins, it doesn't matter if you are committing sins because the belief is already in your heart and that's what counts. So there were this group. There were the Mu'tazilis who had their own form of belief in which they said, no, the reasoning of man is what determines everything and is going to be the source of judgment. But indeed, they believed that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created the creation and left them. He pulled his hands back off of them. And he had nothing to do with the creation after that. Mankind did what mankind did. And Allah's will had no say or no sort of interjection into that matter. So you see that there were all these people in the time of Imam al-Sadiq alayhi salatu wassalam, and you see the activities of our beloved Imam, that in every moment he is teaching, he is sharing his knowledge, and he had some great, great students. One of those students is a man named Zurara ibn A'yun, or A'yan. Zurara ibn A'yun ibn Sunsun, his name, that's what his full name was. Some people say that his family was Christian and that they converted to Islam. Other people say, no, his family was from the Ahl al-Sunnah and that they came and they found Ahl al-Bayt. Regardless, if you look up and you read about Zurara ibn A'yun, you see that he was one of the best students of Al-Imam al-Baqir alayhi salam and Al-Imam al-Sadiq alayhi salam. And that Zurara, he spent his life close to Imam and learning from Imam. And one of the important things that you see that Zurara was an expert in fiqh. There were many students who had joined the school of Al-Imam al-Sadiq. But Zurara was one who, he was an expert in fiqh. He was an expert in jurisprudence. And he was one who Imam relied on a lot to share and to teach others. And you see that even today, that when they teach a lot of the what is called the nas, the text that is used for the jurisprudence, that is used for deriving laws today, that Zurara is one of those trustworthy sources, one of those students of Imam al-Sadiq alayhi salatu wassalam, who was so trustworthy and so known to be of those people of consensus that his words were accepted, that they were coming straight from the Imam because of his close relationship to the Imam. Now, in that moment, in the time, you see that there are people who are rushing to find Allah. In this moment of thriving, what do you expect will happen? If you were to sit in a classroom and you have a very sort of active discussion on a topic, and the discussion is full of sort of enthusiasm and full of activity, and there's a lot of people giving their advice and a lot of people doing research, what's going to happen? The interest in that subject is going to go up, is it not? People will be interested, and the desire to learn more about that topic will increase. This happened in Medina at that time. There was a great amount of interest, but the problem was that you got factions of people who were now treading the path of Islam in a wrong direction. They were taking Islam in a wrong direction. One was a group of people, without really mentioning any names, who were applying their own opinion to religion. They were doing what is called qiyas or ijtihad bil-ra'i, meaning they were deriving rules based on their own opinion and based on what they thought was correct. Another group was disregarding all of those sort of practical aspects and just staying with the spiritual aspects. And they were the people who were saying, no, we don't want to live in this physical life. We want to get rid of all of our clothing and our possession, and we live out in the wilderness, and all we do is pray and pray and pray all the time and nothing else. And you see people like that today even, who sit and behave in this manner. And they also were leading in a direction that was not the correct direction of Islam. You also find the school of Ahlul Bayt, who walked the line of moderation. And you see this, that the school of Imam al-Sadiq alayhi salam is the school of moderation. It is the school of finding balance. Worship, spirituality, prayerfulness, but also practicality, implementation, making society better, helping those in need, searching out the deficits of society, the deficits of community, and improving it. And that's why you see, they say about it, Al-Imam al-Sadiq alayhi salam, that we would see him doing always one of three things, it is reported. Either he was praying, or he was fasting, or he was reading the Holy Quran. They say that. And clearly, he was out in the middle of the night feeding the poor. Clearly, he was teaching the students. Clearly, he was answering the questions of the people. Clearly, he was seeking out those in need to improve society. There was a balance. Unfortunately, my dear brothers and sisters, in the process of this religion, which I mentioned to you, requires proper practice, meaning you pray on time. If Allah says to pray at this time, you pray. If Allah says to fast, you fast. If Allah says don't eat this, don't eat that. And Allah teaches you to sort of follow this practical code, and that by doing so, you elevate yourself and get closer to His understanding. There were some people, unfortunately, who amongst the Shia had let go of this. And amongst the Shia, they unfortunately had become quite extreme in their behavior. And they had chosen a path of extremism. And you see this, that unfortunately, when you have groups of people who are engaged in scholarly discussion, there are going to be those who are extremely liberal, who take things very lightly, who don't take it properly. You're going to have people in the middle who are moderate, who take it properly, apply it the way it should, but don't go to the extremes. And then on the other extreme of the liberal is the absolutely extreme conservative that we talk about. And in this case, it's not even conservative, is not even the right term. They are just extreme. And these are the people who are known as al-ghulat. Al-ghulat existed at the time of al-Imam al-Sadiq alayhi salam. And al-Imam al-Sadiq alayhi salam, he spoke about them very sternly. And why am I mentioning this to you? Because I said to you that religion is taklif in the beginning. It is about obeying what God says. God says to do something, you do it. You don't question. You don't ask for the reason. You don't ask for the justification. You just do it because God said to do it. Because you are the slave of God, you do it. And in the process of doing that, you bring awareness of why you are doing it and who you are doing it to please. And the goal behind doing it as being a betterment, not only for yourself, but for society as well. Al-Imam al-Sadiq, he spoke very strictly and sternly about the ghulat. The ghulat are the extremists. And Al-Imam al-Sadiq alayhi salam, they say that when he was addressing those Shia of his group who had become quite extreme, he said about them, and they say this riwayah has been reported by different sources, but it is reported to come from Al-Imam al-Sadiq alayhi salatu wasalam, in which Al-Imam al-Sadiq alayhi salam, he says to his companions, directly speaking to his students, he says, احذروا على شبابكم الغلات لا يفسدونهم. He says, make sure that your youth are aware and make your youth aware of the ghulat, of the extremists. And he's not talking about extremists of another sect. He's talking about the extremists in Shi'ism who claim to follow his school, the school of Ahlul Bayt. So now he is saying to his companions, he says, احذروا على شبابكم الغلات لا يفسدونهم. Make your youth aware of the extremists. Why? Because the extremists will fill them with fasad. They will take them in the wrong direction and they will corrupt them. فَإِنَّ الْغُلَاةِ شَرُّ خَلْقِ اللَّهِ. Now look what he says. He says the extremists are the worst of Allah's creation. They are the worst of Allah's creation. See how beautiful the religion is. It's not saying that go so far in one extreme and that's what's going to make you a good Muslim. No. Imam Sadiq, he says, the extremists are the worst of God's creation. Why? He says, يُصَغِّرُونَ عَظَمَةِ اللَّهِ. He says, they take the grandeur of God and they make it small. What an amazing statement. He says, they take the grandeur of Allah, the greatness of Allah, and they reduce it. They make it small. They take Allah to be small. Why? You would think it's the opposite, don't you? You see these extremists today who are saying, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar. They're saying these words, but Imam Sadiq is saying, no, in fact, it's the opposite. They are reducing the greatness of God. They have reduced Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and they value God less. Imam Sadiq alayhi salam, he says, وَيَدَّعُونَ الرُّبُوبِيَّ لِعِبَادِ اللَّهِ. He says, instead of making Allah the Lord, instead of making Allah the Rabb, he says, they make human beings the Rabb. He says, they make other people to be the Lords. He says, وَاللَّهِ إِنَّ الْغُلَاةَ شَرٌ مِنَ الْيَهُودِ وَالنَّصَارَ وَالْمَجُوسِ وَالَّذِينَ أَشْرَكُوا. He says, by Allah, he says, the extremists are worse than your enemies of the Christian, of the Jews, of the disbelievers. The extremists from your own group are worse in the eyes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then he says, إِلَيْنَا يَرْجِعُ الْغَالِي فَلَا نَقْبَلُهُ. He says, one day, the extremists always come back to us, come back to the Ahlul Bayt. They are our Shia. They believe in the Imams. He says, one day, they always come back to us asking for acceptance and we reject them. Imam says, he says, we reject them. فَلَا نَقْبَلُهُ. وَبِنَا يَلْحَقُ الْمُقَصِّرُ فَنَقْبَلُهُ. He says, on the other hand, another person comes to us who is our follower, but who makes mistakes, who has shortcomings in him or her. When they come to us, we will accept them. The extremist we will not accept, but the one who comes, who's got shortcoming, who's making mistakes, and they come to us with penitent head, with humility, we accept them. So that someone asked, he said, كَيْفَ ذَلِكَ ابْنَ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ? The companions asked, they said, O grandson of the Prophet, why is it that you reject the extremist, but you accept those who have shortcoming in their religious practice, those who make mistakes? Imam, he answers, he says, لِأَنَّ الْغَالِي قَدْ اِعْتَادَ تَرْكَ الصَّلَاةِ وَالزَّكَاةِ وَالصِّيَامِ وَالْحَجِّ فَلَا يَقْدِرُ عَلَى تَرْكِ عَادَتِهِ وَعَلَى الرُّجُوعِ إِلَى طَاعَةِ اللَّهِ عَزَّ وَجَلْ أَبَدًا. He says, these extremists, they have indeed left off doing salat, they have left off doing zakat, they have left off doing what the fasting and the hajj, and they cannot give up their way of life, the way that they have engaged in what they consider to be proper religion, and now they cannot return back to the obedience of Allah. Why? Because they went to the far extreme. They went to the complete extreme. And he says, وَإِنَّ الْمُقَصِّرُ إِذَا عَرَفَ عَمِلَ وَأَطَاعَ. As for the other group, the ones who didn't know and who were making lots of mistakes and not following properly, you will find, Imam says, that if you teach them what is correct, then they will implement it and they will obey. They will do what they are supposed to do. Because there is a difference between these two groups. My dear brothers and sisters, why am I telling you this? Because in the time of the Imamat, the greatest scholarship was in the time of Al-Imam As-Sadiq. Greatest amount of discourse was in the time of Al-Imam As-Sadiq. Yet you saw that in the time of Al-Imam As-Sadiq, these groups were coming up everywhere. There were so many of these groups. Not only the Zaydis, not only the Kaysaniya, not only the Murji'a, the Mu'tazila, all of these groups, the Khawarij were already there. Not only were all of these groups there, but there were all of these mixed ideas that are coming out. Why? Because human being suddenly thinks that he's got scholarship and intelligence and he knows how to course his life and how to shape his religion according to what he thinks is correct. And yet what I said to you in the beginning is that religion is about taklif. It is about surrender, and it is about saying that I submit my head in front of God and practice the way God has told me to practice and implement the way God has told me how to implement. Why? Because he is the sovereign. He is the decider. He is the one who has chosen it for us. And in doing that, when you implement that, believe me, you do it with a penitent heart, one that is submitting to Allah, you will find your understanding of God will increase. The more obedience you have to Allah, the more trust you have in what He's asking you to do, the more you will find you have this feeling of closeness to Him, this feeling of love for Him that would not exist otherwise. And that is the way of religion. And Imam Sadiq, alayhi salatu wassalam, he provided us through his many students the avenues towards getting here. Students like Zurara ibn Ayun, students like Hisham ibn al-Hakam, students like the brothers of Zurara ibn Ayun, many other students that he had, Abu Basir, who was a great companion of Al-Imam al-Sadiq alayhi salatu wassalam, people who they showed you the different ways of learning about God's religion, from the fiqh to the haqa'id, to the usul, to the mu'amalat, to the akhlaq, to every aspect. And the more you learn, the more well-rounded you become from every aspect, the deeper your understanding of God. It is not just from one way. Why? Because Islam is a way of life. Islam is a way of doing things. And you see that our imams will never leave us. Our imams will never depart from us. They are with us. They are always helping us, because not only did they show us the path to God, they also showed us that they are going to be standing there with their hands over our heads and carrying our dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You know that the persecution that our beloved imam faced, it had started long ago with the Banu Umayyah. And that Hisham ibn Abdul Malik, la'natullahi alayh, had demanded that his father Al-Baqir and him come up towards Damascus and up towards Sham, and had threatened them and had questioned them. And it was a relentless persecution. And so that even when Banu Umayyah left and Banu Abbas took power, took the reins of power, in some ways, they were even more tyrannical upon the Ahl al-Bayt because of the jealousy that they held, because of the contention that why is Ali different from our father Abbas, who was the uncle of Rasulullah? Why does Ali get this special position when our uncle Abbas had this great position with Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam? And you see that Mansur al-Dawaniqi and the family of the Banu Abbas that now took the reins of power and established themselves in Baghdad and in the surrounding regions, they constantly threatened our imam. They constantly threatened the well-being of our imam. And once it is reported that a man named Rabi'a, who was the attendant of the Abbasi Khalif, he called Rabi'a and he said, go to Jafar ibn Muhammad and come in on his house, don't knock on his door, don't take permission, go enter into his house and immediately remove him and bring him to us, call him over to us and do so immediately. And by Allah, this Abbasi Khalif, he says, he's going to die at my hands, I am going to kill him. So they say that this man Rabi', he goes and there is nothing he can do because he has been threatened with death himself by the Abbasi Khalifa. He sees Imam al-Sadiq alayhi salam and he comes in, he says, O grandson of the Prophet, he says, I ask your pardon of what I have to do, but my life and the well-being of my family is at risk if I do not take you with me to go see the Abbasi Khalifa. Imam al-Sadiq alayhi salam, he says, do what you have been commanded, don't worry about me. Rabi'a takes al-Imam al-Sadiq alayhi salam. He goes and he takes Imam al-Sadiq alayhi salam. When they come in towards the courtyard of the Abbasi Khalif, they enter in there. Rabi'a, he knows, he's thinking in his mind that this is it is the end. He says, I saw at the near the seat of the Abbasi Khalif, his throne or wherever he was sitting, that there was a metal rod next to him. And Rabi'a says, I thought in my mind that this Khalifa is going to take the metal rod and he is going to kill Ja'far ibn Muhammad and as-Sadiq alayhim as-salam. He says, feeling this, I saw Ja'far ibn Muhammad come in And when he came into the courtyard, the Abbasi Khalif, he called him to come close. And as he came close, Rabi' says, I could see the lips of Ja'far ibn Muhammad moving. I could see his lips moving, like he was saying something, but I was not close enough to hear what he was saying. As he came close up to the Khalifa. Rabi' says, I thought that the Abbasi Khalifa is going to take the rod and he's going to kill him. He's going to harm him in some way. But instead, he greeted him with warmth. He sat him down next to him. He treated him as a guest, talked to him, and then released him to go home. Rabi' says, I had to escort Ja'far ibn Muhammad back home. And as I was escorting him back home, he says, I asked him. He says, I was almost certain that today, tonight, that the Abbasi Khalifa is going to kill you. In fact, I knew that that's what his plan was when he had asked me to bring you to his courtyard, to his court, to his presence. He says, I saw that something amazing happened and that instead of threatening you or harming you, that instead he treated you with respect and kindness and reverence, in fact. He says, how did that happen? He says, I saw, O Ja'far ibn Muhammad, that you were reciting something from your lips in that moment when you had come into the courtyard. What were you saying? Al-Imam al-Sadiq alayhi salatu wassalam, it is reported that he said, I have learned from my fathers, from my forefathers, and always this was their way, that they would say that I learned from my father, who learned from his father, who learned from his father, who learned from his father, who learned from Amir al-Mu'mineen, who learned from Rasulullah, such and such a thing. So Al-Imam al-Sadiq, he says, O Rabi', he says, what I was reciting under my breath was the following dua. And this dua saved me from his evil, from the evil of the Abbasi Khalif. Rabi' says, I asked, what is that dua? Al-Imam al-Sadiq alayhi salam, he says, that dua is Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, Hasbi al-Rabbu min al-Marbubin, wa Hasbi al-Khaliqu min al-Makhluqin. He says, for me sufficient that I should turn to the Rabb and not to those who are the slaves of the Rabb, who are owned by the Rabb. And sufficient for me is that I turned to the Creator and not to the created. Wa Hasbi al-Raziqu min al-Marzuqin, wa Hasbi Allahu Rabbul Alameen. Allah, the one who is the bestower, who gives everyone, I turn to him for recourse and not to those who need him to give to them. I'm meaning the rest of us, all of creation. I turn and Allah is sufficient for me because he is Rabbul Alameen. Hasbi man huwa hasbi. Hasbi man lam yazal hasbi. He says, he is the one. Who is he, Ya Allah? Is there anyone like you who I can turn to who would be sufficient for me other than you and who would remain there with me by my side other than you? Hasbi Allah, la ilaha illa huwa alayhi tawakkalt wa huwa rabbul arshil azim. My sufficient for me is Allah. There is no God but Allah. There is no one. I have depended on him. And upon him do I depend because he is the Lord of the Arsh. My dear brothers and sisters, this is the way of the Ahlul Bayt. And this is the understanding of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that we inculcate into ourselves. And the recourse that we take consciously, always do it consciously. Every act you do, do it consciously. From salat, to eating, to drinking, to sleeping, do it consciously as one being done for the sake of closeness to Allah, for the sake of greater understanding of Allah. Don't make it just something that you do habitually. One of the other things that Imam inculcated on us was Salat. That they say that in the last moments of his life when he was poisoned and he was lying on his deathbed and he was unconscious, he was asleep, he was not awake, and suddenly he woke up. And when he woke up and regained consciousness, he called all of his family members, his children particularly. And he said to them, he said to the lady who was there, Hamida, he said, go get all my children, all my family. So she went and she told everyone that please come. He woke up and he has called everyone suddenly. He is in the last moments. They all came. They stood around Ja'far ibn Muhammad and As-Sadiq alayhim as-salam. Our Imam opened up his eyes when everyone was gathered. And he says, "La yanalu shafa'atuna al-mustakhif bi salatihi." He says, those people who take their salat to be a joke, those people who treat their salat lightly, will never get our intercession. They will never get the intercession of the Ahl al-Bayt. This is not just about the timeliness of your salat. This is not just how many rak'at of prayer you do in a day. It is about the understanding with which you pray, the devotion with which you pray, the feeling with which you approach your prayer mat to pray. That is what Al-Imam As-Sadiq alayhi salatu wassalam is saying. Indeed, you want to be on time. You don't want to miss. You want to stay completely observant of all the rules. But it is also about the philosophy of that salat and what it is creating. And Al-Imam As-Sadiq alayhi salatu wassalam, like all the A'imma al-Athar, like every one of our imams, they pointed to one place that was very dear to their hearts. They pointed to one ground, one earth, where they told their followers that find yourself here always, because this is where our hearts are. The hearts of the Ahl al-Bayt, the heart of Rasulullah, the heart of Amir al-Mu'mineen, the heart of Fatima al-Zahra. So much so that one day when a man came to Al-Imam al-Sadiq alayhi salam, and he sat with him, he bid salam on Al-Imam al-Sadiq alayhi salam. Imam al-Sadiq replied. The man began to weep, profusely began to weep. Al-Imam al-Sadiq alayhi salam, he said, "Ya Sheikh," he was an older man. He says, "Oh Sheikh," he says, "why do you weep?" The old man, he says, "Ya Ibn Rasulillah, I am weeping because we have waited anxiously to see you come to the position that you deserve, that was chosen for you by Allah, for you to be dignified and honored in the earth, but yet still today you are trampled upon and you are disregarded. We are looking for that day, and not seeing you in your rightful position has caused pain in our hearts, and we weep." Al-Imam al-Sadiq alayhi salatu wassalam, he says, "Oh Shaykh, don't worry." He says, "You will be counted as the companion of Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad alayhim as-salatu wassalam." He says, "Don't worry, because even if you die today and you are not alive to see the return of us to our rightful position, when the day of judgment comes, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will raise you up in the company of Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad alayhim as-salatu wassalam." The old man, he calms down. It is reported Imam as-Sadiq alayhi salatu wassalam, he says, "Oh Sheikh," he says, "I hear your voice from your way you are speaking, your accent, that you are from Iraq." He says, "Where are you from?" The old man, he says, "I am from close to Kufa. I'm from outside of Kufa." Al-Imam al-Sadiq, he says, "Where are you with respect to Karbala? How far are you from Karbala?" The old man, he says, "I am not far from Karbala. I am very close." Al-Imam al-Sadiq alayhi salam, he says, "Old man, do you visit the shrine of my grandfather, the grave of my grandfather, Al-Hussein?" The old man, he says, "Yes, Ya Ibn Rasulillah, I go there all the time." Al-Imam al-Sadiq, he says, "Ya Sheikh, ذَاكَ الدَّمْ يَطْلَبُ اللَّهُ تَعَالَى بِهِ." He says, "That is the blood of Al-Hussein. Allah will question why it was spilled. مَا أُصِيبَ وُلْدِ فَاطِمَا وَلَا يُصَابُونَ بِمِثْلِ الْحُسَيْنِ." He says, oh Sheikh, he says, "None of the children of Fatima have been afflicted and tried the way Al-Hussein was tried, have faced difficulty and suffered the way Al-Hussein suffered. وَلَقَدْ قُتِلَ فِي سَبْعَةَ عَشَرْ مِنْ أَهْلِ بَيْتِهِ." He was martyred and killed between the hands of 17 of his relatives, losing them as well. نَصَحُوا لِلَّهِ وَصَبَرُوا فِي جَنْبِ اللَّهِ. He says, these were the people who stood for God's religion, and they were patient to uphold what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had ordained. فَجَزَاهُمُ اللَّهُ أَحْسَنَ جَزَاءَ الصَّابِرِينَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala rewarded them the best of the reward that is given to those who are patient. He says, "Ya Sheikh," Al-Imam al-Sadiq, he says, "أَنَّهُ إِذَا كَانَ يَوْمُ الْقِيَامَةِ." If the day of judgment comes, أَقْبَلَ رَسُولَ اللَّهِ ومعه الحسين ويده على رأسه يقطر دما. On the day of judgment, Rasulullah will come forward. Al Hussein will be with him. His hand will be on top of the head. وسيعلم وسيعلم الذين ظلموا آل محمد أي منقلب ينقلبون والعاقبة للمتقين إن لله وإنا إليه راجعون. باسمك العظيم الأعظم الأعز الأجل الأكرم يا الله، اللهم إنا نسألك وندعوك ونقسم عليك بحق الزهراء وأبيها وبعلها وبنيها والسر المستودع فيها لعن الله ظالميها. اللهم شافي كل مريض، اللهم رد كل غريب، اللهم فك كل أسير، اللهم غير سوء حالنا بحسن حالك يا كريم، اللهم وفقنا لمراضيك وجنبنا معاصيك وثبت أقدامنا على صراطك المستقيم وخذ بأيدينا إليك يا أرحم الراحمين وفرج عنا يا الله فرجا عاجلا قريبا كلمح البصر أو أقرب من ذلك، وافرغ علينا صبرا وتوفنا مسلمين. والصلاة والسلام على سيدنا محمد وآله الطيبين الطاهرين صلى الله عليه وسلم.